different scriptures tonight, just walk us through a few different things. Meant to be more or less just a word of encouragement, I guess. Sometimes we just need scripture that kind of lifts us up, kind of encourages us. Scripture that kind of focuses us. And it may not be anything, I'm sure it's not anything that probably people haven't heard in the past. And couldn't stand up here and probably teach yourselves in most cases in pretty familiar territory. But we still need that, don't we? And the example I always use is, you know, you look at a professional athlete, you know, Michael Jordan, with all the years when he played basketball, when he was a dominant basketball player in the world, he still had coaches, didn't he? And those coaches still called time out and talked to him. Well, they didn't teach him anything new about basketball. What they did was help remind him to stay focused on the basic things that he knew. And that goes for any sport, whether it be basketball or football or baseball or golf, what have you. They all have instructors and coaches who help them stay focused on the basics and the fundamentals. And sometimes as a pastor, that's kind of what we do, is just remind people to stay focused on the basics and the fundamentals, those areas where it's so easy to kind of to wander off and get off track. And Ephesians chapter 6:10 to me is one of those scriptures that just kind of reminds us of that, to help us continue to be focused. And I'll read it real quick. It says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." We're to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We're to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And you know, sir, it don't say be strong in the Lord and the power of our might. It doesn't say be strong in the Lord and the power of America's might. It doesn't say be strong in the Lord and the power of somebody else's might. But it says be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. His might. His might. And I know that's a very basic and simple thing to think of. Well, yeah, I'm supposed to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. But we're going to look at just a few scriptures tonight that help us understand how to be strong in the power of his might and not ours. That's one of the most basic things that the Word of God teaches us. We can go all through the scriptures, all through every book, and find some place there where it teaches us of the benefits of being strong in the power of his might, and it shows us the defeat that people end up with when they begin to put their trust and their focus in the power of somebody else's might. One of the examples that you hear me use all the time is King Asa. And King Asa in 2 Chronicles chapter 16 is a graphic illustration of that, where he saw great victories when he had his trust in the Lord and was walking in the power of God's might. He saw great victories. But then he turns right around and he enters into covenant with the king of Assyria. And as soon as he does that, he begins to try to walk in the power of that covenant between him and Assyria. And he automatically begins to get defeated. And God even sent a prophet to him, as I often share, and tried to tell him, you know what, when you put your trust in the Lord, you walk in victory. When you put your trust in this covenant with the Assyrians, you walk in defeat. But he didn't receive it. He just totally rejected the prophet's message, totally pushed that away, and we see his demise, and he ended up dying with an affliction of his foot because he didn't seek the Lord. And so, again, there was that very simple, that very graphic illustration of putting our trust and our faith in the might of God, or putting our trust or our faith in the abilities of mankind, or our trust in our faith even in our own abilities and our own skills. You know, the example of Samson was a classic example again in the scriptures, where Samson did all these great feats of strength and might and won these great victories. Why? He didn't do it in his own strength. I remember when I was a child, they had these cartoons, and there was one cartoon I remembered that had Hercules and Samson in there, and there were these big, burly, strong men. I don't think for a moment that that's what Samson looked like. I think Samson was a small man. I can't prove that, but I think he was. Why? Because God uses the weak things of the world to confound the mighty, doesn't he? Yeah. And so Samson was a graphic illustration of what happened when the anointing or the Spirit of God came upon him. Then he was able to do great feats of strength. Why? Because it was God's might and God's strength, and not a man's strength and not a man's might. We see that again, one of the classic stories of the Bible that we hear all the time, David and Goliath. And when David went up against Goliath, this giant of a man, I'm sure that he wasn't putting his trust in his might or his strength. He wasn't thinking, boy, I can do 5,000 push-ups, I can bring Goliath down. He wasn't thinking, boy, you know, I can bench 500 pounds, I can bring Goliath down. No, when he went against Goliath, he was remembering the victories that he had in the the Lord, when God empowered him to slay a bear, when God empowered him to slay a lion, and he said, the same God who empowered me to do that is the same God that's going to bring down Goliath. So he was able to see tremendous victory because he had placed his faith in the might and the power of God. So whatever we're facing, whatever battles we're in, whatever we're up against, beloved, we have to understand, if we're truly walking with our faith in the power and the might of God, we're going to see victory. But if our trust and our faith is placed somewhere else, we're going to see defeat. So this is a very simple verse, but of utmost importance in all of God's words. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. My strength is not in me. My strength is not in my abilities. My strength is in the power of His might. Now, if I'm tapping into His might, and you're tapping into His might, then we got some stuff going. If we're walking in His might, then we're very strong. And I'm just going to walk you through a few scriptures tonight that talks about this and look at them in different capacities. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Where's that strength? Where's that might at? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And one of the most basic things again, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. But notice this treasure. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. So we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the power may be not of us, but of God. So that is, the Bible says that, that's a treasure. A treasure if we're walking in the power of God. A treasure if we're walking in the might of God. And it says we have that treasure, we're in earthen vessels. Well, you and I are earthen vessels, aren't we? We're all made out of dirt. Amen? God took dirt and he put a shape and a form and he breathed into it and it came and created life. It's how the humanity came about. We're all made from dirt. Amen? Y'all looking at me kind of funny. We're made out of dirt. And God breathed life into us. So we are earthen vessels. Each and every one of us are made out of earthen materials. We're from this planet. We're from this earth. But the treasure that you and I have is that you and I, as believers, can reveal and manifest the power of God right here on this planet through us and in us. You see, one of the things that I want us to look at tonight, one of the things I want us to see is where the power of God is. Where the power of God resides is on the inside of the believer. And that's something we miss quite often. Go to Ephesians chapter 3. We're there this morning. Ephesians chapter 3. Verse number 20. That's the scripture I didn't get to this morning. But it really wasn't the heart and soul of what we're talking about. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. And we hear this scripture quoted a lot, but again, this is one of those verses that people can pull up short on. We hear the first part of this all the time. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. We hear that all the time, don't we? He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. God is a God who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think. I hear that quoted that way all the time, but notice the rest of the verse. According to the power that does what? Worketh in us. So God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the power that resides on the inside of the believer. According to the power that dwells and lives within these earthen vessels. The power of God resides on the inside of the believer. What does the scripture say? Greater is he who is in you than he that is in the world. Where is the greater one at? In you. Greater is he who is in you than he that is in the world. You know, it's an amazing thing, and sometimes I'll sit and just kind of think about this stuff, and it just astounds me. Beloved, God lives on the inside of us. God lives on the inside of the believer. God is on the inside of us. Greater is he who is in you than he that's in the world. Know you not that you are you need lives on the inside of you. Everything in this world needs lives on the inside of you. Greater is he who is in you than he that's in the world. Y'all looking at me kind of funny. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 now. Let's look at that. Where we're looking at, the focus right now is in us. The power of God that is in us. The greater one who is in us. The battle that is in us. You know, as believers, the greatest battles we face are on the inside, not on the outside. Amen? The greatest battles we fight are on the inside, not on the outside. Most of our battles we fight up here. Most of our battles we fight in here. Most of the time when the enemy's able to make inroads in our life, he does it on the inside of us, not on the outside. I'm going to show you that in the Word of God, 2 Corinthians chapter 10. This is where the battle's at. Verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. To the pulling down of strongholds. So the weapons we have are mighty through God. So again, there's that might of God. There's that power of God. Pulling down strongholds. Now, where does that take place? Notice verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, go back. If casting down imaginations, where are your imaginations at? On the inside of you, aren't they? Okay. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, where's your knowledge at? And bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Where's your thoughts at? So it's talking about the power of God and the might of God doing warfare. It's talking about the weaponry of God. But it's talking about a battle or warfare that's taking place on the inside of the believer. It's talking about a warfare or a battle that is taking place in our lives. Now, I don't know about you guys, but have you ever been discouraged? Where does that happen at? That happens on the inside of us, don't it? Have you ever been depressed? Where does that happen at? On the inside of us, doesn't it? You know, according to the Word of God, one of the number one weapons that Satan has against mankind is fear. Now, where does fear happen at? On the inside of us, doesn't it? So you see, all these battles and these warfares we're talking about, you know, we want to talk about the power of God, we want to talk about the might of God, and we want to, you know, out here some great and mighty miracle, and you know, the Red Sea is hardened, and we walk down through it, and all that kind of stuff, but the real battles we fight primarily are on the inside of us on a daily basis. It tells us to cast down imaginations. It tells us to bring our thought life into obedience to Christ, doing that by the weaponry and the might of God. You know, one of the greatest lessons I learned in this area, there was a time in my walk with the Lord when I really battled discouragement. And I mean, I really battled discouragement. I went through the time where I could be sitting here and just on top of the world praising God, woo, glory to God, and I could get up, and I use this illustration because it happens many times to me. And I'd get up and walk across the room. And before I had walked from one side of the room to the other, I went from boom, boom. I went from just being on top of the world to just feeling totally discouraged. Just instantly like that. And I thought, you know, that's not normal. A person shouldn't just go from one extreme to the other. And I began to pray and seek the Lord about it. And you know, God, when you ask God questions, have you ever noticed God just bluntly gives us answers? I mean, God doesn't hint around or beat around the bush so he don't hurt our feelings. I mean, God, what has happened to me? Why do I get so discouraged? He made it simple. He says, because your eyes are in the wrong place. I said, what do you mean, Lord? My eyes are in the wrong place. He says, you're looking at the wrong place. What do you mean, Lord? He says, you're not looking at my word. And I've told people that in the past. They said, me all discouraged. I said, well, you're not looking at the word. I'm a dog down in the press, but you're not looking at the Word. uplift you. The only thing that's in here is encouragement. The only thing that's in here is strength. The only thing that in here is power. The only thing in here is might. The only thing in here is victory. How could you possibly be discouraged if your eyes are upon the Word? You see, that's where the battle is. I wasn't being attacked out here by a discouraging situations anymore, you know, 30 seconds before then to 30 seconds later. Same battles, the same struggles in life that were always there were there. But what had happened is I had allowed myself to take my eyes off of the promises of God and put my eyes upon the circumstances of life. And that's why I can go from, whoo, praise God, look at the promises, look at the victory, look at what my God's doing in my life, look at what the glory of God is doing, to begin to look at the problem to, oh my gosh. You see, the battle of circumstances hadn't changed. Situation hadn't changed. Something had changed on the inside of my life. And I'd taken my eyes off of the Lord, off of His Word, and put them on the circumstances of the world. Can I share something with you? There is no biblical reason to be discouraged. But there's plenty of worldly reasons to be discouraged. And if you're looking at this world and the message in, then you're probably pretty discouraged. But if you're looking at this Word and the promises thereof, there's no reason whatsoever to be discouraged. Beloved, as believers, we've got to understand where these battles are. We've got to understand where this warfare is. It's talking about something that is taking place on the inside of us, something that is taking place in our thoughts, in our imagination, and if we're thinking on the Word, we're walking in victory. If we're thinking on the things of this world, we're walking in defeat. If our imaginations and our meditations are upon the things of this world, then our imaginations and our meditations upon this Word, we're going to have completely different results. I mean, if you don't believe me, I just go home and just turn on the news. It don't take more than a few minutes to depress you, does it? I mean, that'll run your day quick. You know, I remember my grandparents, they were pretty set in their patterns in life. They got up at the same time every day, went to bed at the same time every day, ate popcorn at the same time every night. You know, ate ice cream at some times then, you know, but they always did the same. But I remember when I was kids, they would watch the news right before they went to bed. 10 o'clock news, 10 to 10:30, go to bed. I think about that now, I think, my goodness, what a depressing thing to think about right before you go to bed. Wouldn't it? I mean, if you watch the news from 10 to 10:30 now and went to bed, you'd probably have nightmares, wouldn't you? You better realize that there's warfare taking place there. There's battle taking place there. And we're talking about this right here, casting down imaginations, casting down strongholds, casting down these things, bringing our thoughts in obedience to Christ, to the might and the power of God. Why? Because that's where the battleground is taking place. That's the number one battleground in our life. There was a guy that many of you probably heard of, Francis Frangipane.
Yes.
And that's just got a nice sound to that name, doesn't it? Frangipane. And he wrote a book called, Three Worlds? What was it, Donna Sue?
Three battlegrounds.
And he talked about the three battlegrounds. And one thing I remember, he was dealing with spiritual warfare. And he, you know, broke it down a little bit from what I remember. It's been years since I read it. But the first battleground we have to see victory in is inside of us. You know, everybody wants to fight spiritual warfare and, you know, take over the city. Well, the first place you got to do battle with is right here. On the inside of us. We've got to get victory in our own heads before we take victory to the world. And the next thing would be, then you begin to deal with get victory in your home. Then you really expand out and get victory in your church. And then you begin to take your victory to the community. But see, what happens a lot of times, everybody wants to go on the front lines and fight these spiritual warfares and these spiritual battles, and they haven't dealt with what's on the inside of themselves, and they're lunch for Satan. They haven't dealt with this level. Hallelujah. You with me so far? Go to Ephesians chapter 6 again. Because I want to show you something here. And I'm going to read out of 2 Corinthians chapter 10, where we were just at. I just read chapter 10, 2 Corinthians. Let me reread that again. For though we walk in the flesh, we do, and that's verse 3, we do not war after the flesh. And then it goes on, and that's where it talks about the weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but mighty through God, pulling down strongholds, casting down imagination, so on and so forth. But it says something there in 1:4, we don't war after the flesh. And we don't war after the flesh, and we don't do these battles after the flesh. Then how do we do that? Well, we know Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, where we started out, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, and in the power of his might, verse 11, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, I'm not going to go into the whole armor of God and the armor of God. We'll be getting to that as we go through the book of Ephesians. But, beloved, one thing we've got to understand, the weapons we use are not carnal. The weapons we use are described by the word of God. We put on the whole armor of God. I always bring back this, and I can't ever, whenever I talk about the whole armor of God and I'm teaching, I can't ever skip to this point. Why did God give us armor? So we would win the fight. He didn't give us armor so we would be weighed down and beat up. He gave us armor that is designed for us to walk in victory. He gave us armor that is designed to defeat the enemy. The armor he has given us is designed specifically to defeat the enemies that you and I face. The armor he gives us is designed specifically to defeat satanic attacks and stand against the wiles of the devil. So, beloved, we don't fight according to our strength, our might, our power, our ability, but we fight according to putting on the whole armor of God and according to the might of God. Now, it's very important to understand this, beloved, because a lot of times people, we get into battles, we get into struggles, and we've all been through that, I'm sure, and where we get sucked right in to trying to fight the fight the world's way. We get sucked into trying to do it ourselves. We get sucked into doing it our best and trying to do it according to our designs rather than according to God's might and God's power and God's strength and God's way of doing things. And guess what happens? I use this illustration. I know it's goofy. How many of y'all think if I got into a fight with a shark, I'd win? Why are you laughing? I like it when I ask these questions. Everybody just falls out. I guess, how would I do against a state champ in chess? Everybody laughs. Ha 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 ha. I might beat him. I know he is, but you don't know. How would I do against a shark? Everybody says, that shark's going to eat you, right? Well, let me ask you this. Doesn't it depend on where we fight? Now, if we fight in the water, I don't got a chance, do we? If we fight out here in the parking lot, I think I'm whipping. But, you know, eventually he's going to get tired of flapping around out there, not going to be able to move very well. I'm going to dance around like a bat, you know? I think I win the fight in the parking lot. Right? So you got to think these things through. Why am I saying that? Because you know what? If he fights me on my turf, I win. If I fight him on his turf, he wins. If Satan gets us to fight him on his turf, he wins. If we fight him on God's turf, we win. So if we're in a place where we're fighting him and we've got on the whole armor of God and we're fighting him in the might and the strength and the power of God, he doesn't have a chance. But if he can suck us in to trying to fight the fight with carnal weapons, then he wins because we're fighting on his turf. That's like fighting a shark in the water. You see, these things are so simple and so basic, but yet we need to be encouraged with this so much because, beloved, I don't know about you, but isn't it really easy to get sucked into fighting the devil and the carnal weapons? Yeah. Isn't it easy to get sucked into fighting our battles the world's way and trying to fix it the way the world would rather than relying upon the might and the power of God? Yes. I fight that battle all the time. I fight that battle all the time. You know, when we first were looking at moving into this building, I fought that battle tremendously. And I'll tell you how. Because I had approached the owners of the building about us moving in here. Most of my life, done sales. And a big part of my life, I dealt with businesses. And I sit down with businesses, and I do sales, and I work out deals, and I negotiate with the finance companies, and I work cars, and I do all that stuff. But I didn't want to approach the people who own this building that way. I wanted Mike to hush. I didn't want to come in and try to sell my case. I didn't want to try to work out a deal the world's way. I wanted to trust God. You see, it would be easy in those situations for me to begin to rely upon what I do in the world and have done for years, rather than to trust God's way and God's power and God's ability to bring it to pass with His result. And you see, that's how the enemy will tempt us. We think the enemy only tempts us with bad things. But sometimes the enemy will tempt us with our own abilities, our own strengths. And sometimes he will tempt us just to get us to do things that human worldly way, because he knows once he's got us in that turf, then he can eat us alive. Once he gets me functioning like the world, let me take off this armor for a second, go there and handle this. Then he's got me. See, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. You know, the classic example I was saying that was the Battle of Jericho. I mean, here's the city, Jericho. And at that time, the way I understand it, historically, they determined that city was impregnable. There's nothing anybody could do to bring the walls of Jericho down. That city was too powerful, too mighty, it couldn't be touched. Well, with human effort, it probably would have been difficult, huh? But God had a plan, and God had a design. All they had to do was to be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. And God gave them direction, march around the city, and then on the seventh day, march around the city seven times. Don't say a word till the seventh time, and then shout, and walls will come down. Now, if they would have thought, well, wait a second, on the second day, you know, Joshua, this all sounds great, and I know it's, you know, you prophets and all that, this super spiritual stuff works for you, but this just doesn't seem right. I mean, we got some hammers here. We're going to start pounding on this wall and bring this thing down. I mean, you know, you're going to be super spiritual, but we got to go to work here. Guess what would have happened? The walls would probably still be standing, wouldn't they? It'd be a tourist attraction to go see the walls of Jericho that God's people couldn't bring down. But they stayed true and were strong in the Lord and in the power of His might and His ability and His strength and simply followed His directions, and He brought the walls down. You see, if the enemy could have just got them off for just a second, could have just got them trying to do it with their strength, get old Bubba over there, strongest man we got, get the biggest hammer. See what he can do. That's all it would have taken for defeat to come, is to try to pull down strongholds that the enemy has erected with our power, our ability, and our strength. Go ahead, let's look at another instance. 1 Peter chapter 1. Praise the Lord. And this is just one to throw out. 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to look at verse 16. Hallelujah. Praise His name. Praise His name. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. Now listen to what it says here. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Well, just go ahead and do that. Just go ahead and do that with your abilities. Go ahead and do that with your strength. Go ahead and do that with your power. Go ahead and do that with your mind. Well, that's impossible, isn't it? I mean, we can't live holy before God with human abilities and human strength and human willpower, can we? But yet God tells us to do it. So how in the world can we live a holy life and be obedient to God unless there was saved, I tried really hard to be God. After I was saved, I tried really hard to be this real holy saint. And you know what I did? I fell right on my face a lot of times. And I just made myself miserable. Why? Because I was trying to do it with my strength. I was trying to do it with my ability. I was trying to do it with my power. You know, I always have told the story before, and probably most of you have heard it. But again, it brings back our focus on this and understanding this. I shared the story how when I was 25, I got saved. And I came to Christ, and I was bound up with drugs and alcohol, and really my life was a mess. And when I came to Christ, I was coming to Christ looking for Him to deliver me and set me free. And He did. He set me free. He delivered me. But you know what really threw me? What really threw me for a loop was the same God. God didn't do this, but God delivered me from the drugs. God delivered me from the alcohol, and I couldn't get rid of cigarettes. And when I have a hard time, and I'm not talking about a day or two or a week or two. I'm talking about a few years now. And I quit at least 1,000 times. And it really bothered me. Trust me, I did not want to smoke. I felt terrible that I smoked. I felt conviction about smoking. It affected how I breathed and coughed and messed up all the time. I couldn't stand the stupid cigarettes, and yet I couldn't quit them. And I tried, 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 and I tried. And sometimes I would go a while. And I remember one day I just got so frustrated, and I sat down, and I said, Lord, I don't understand this. I mean, I was born again, Lord. I came to Jesus, and boy, you delivered me from the drugs. You delivered me from the alcohol. You delivered me from all the mess that I was in, and now I can't get rid of these cigarettes. Guess what? I just described to you why. I asked God to deliver me from drugs. I asked God to deliver me from alcohol. I asked God to deliver me from the mess. And I can't quit cigarettes. There's a difference there, isn't there? I knew I'd already been through the battles. I'd already been through the drill with the drugs. I'd already been through the battle. I'd already been through the drill with the alcohol. I knew that I couldn't get rid of that mess. That's what brought me to my knees initially. But I thought I could handle the cigarettes on my own. I thought I could quit them. I didn't realize how addicting they really were. And finally the day came, I said, Lord, He delivered me from the drugs. He delivered me from the alcohol. I'm going to believe He delivered me from the cigarettes. Don't that sound like David fighting Goliath? The same God who delivered me from the lion, the same God who delivered me from the bear, the same God who delivered me from the alcohol, the same God who delivered me from the drugs, is the same God who's going to deliver me from cigarettes, is the same God who's going to give me a victory every battle I face throughout all of eternity, is the same God who's going to deliver me from anything the enemy tries to bring upon me throughout all eternity. It's the same God. He has the strength and the power and the mind and the ability to deliver us from any affliction we ever come up against in life. But the thing is, we've got to trust in His might, His power, His ability, and not try to do it on our own. And that's the enemy sucking us into his turf. Be ye holy. How can I do that? Strictly by the power of God. How can I live right? Strictly by the power of God. I can't do it with my ability. I can't do it with my strength. My ability won't give me 10 seconds worth of living right. It's not in the human to do it. It's in the power of God. Amen? Amen. Romans chapter 6. Here's where the heart and soul of all that is. Romans 6, verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Body of sin over that old man, that old nature, is by the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. What ultimately, initially, what set me free, as what I just shared, from the drugs and the alcohol, is I realized something. When I came to Jesus Christ, his death was my death. His burial was my burial. His resurrection was my resurrection. His ascension on the right hand of the Father was my ascension. So what does that mean? I became a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things are passed away and all things become new. The drug addict was dead. The alcoholic was dead. That crazy person had died. I left him in a grave. I was a brand new creation, a brand new man. Jesus Christ had become sin for me that I might be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am a new creation. That old man is dead. He's still buried, and he's still in the grave. That's what that's saying right there. That old man was destroyed. See, that word destroyed there is like going and taking a lamp and whew, just pulling it out from the electrical socket. It's separating it from its power source. Now, I couldn't have ever done that. No human being could have ever done that. We have to be strong in the power of God. And you see, beloved, no matter what we're facing in life, I'll guarantee you that the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is sufficient for you to get victory in that battle. I'll guarantee you everything you'll ever need, every supply you'll ever need, every victory you'll ever need, anything you'll ever need in life throughout all of eternity is already there in Christ and Him crucified. All we have to do is to tap into it. Yes. Be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Be strong in the Lord and in Christ and Him crucified. But we want to try to do it our own way. We want to try to do it our own self. We don't want to look to Him. Amen. Let me look at something else real quick. Go to James chapter 4. Last key point. James chapter 4. Verse 7. James chapter 4. Verse 7. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, think about this. I mean, if it's me and the devil head to head, we get down in our football positions here. Who's going to win that? Probably him. I mean, I don't know. I suppose he's probably stronger than I am. Don't you imagine? So how can I resist him? Again, we look at that and say, how can, I mean, me against the devil? What chance do I have? I mean, he's more powerful than I am, isn't he? He's no doubt stronger than I am. He's no doubt mightier than I am. And that goes for all of us, doesn't it? I mean, if we arm wrestle the devil, how many of you think we'd win? He'd probably win now, wouldn't he? So how can we possibly resist him? We'd have to be strong in the Lord, wouldn't we? And in the power of His might. You see, it says that I'm supposed to resist the devil. Now, if it's Mike against the devil, I don't got a chance. But you know, in reality, he don't have a chance. I got something for you. Jesus! Battle's over. That's how I resist it. I don't do it in my strength, I don't do it in my power, I don't do it in my ability, but the Lord has given us authority to use His name. The name above all names. The name that He has to bow to. The name of the one who's already defeated Him. my ability. I don't do it with my strength. You don't do it with your ability. You don't do it with your strength. But it says there that if we resist him, he will flee from us. And like I shared, that word flee there is really a neat word in the Greek. It means just turn and run as hard as you can and get out of town. It means tuck your tail and run. Why? Because he can't stand the name of Jesus. You see, beloved, we got to realize we have weapons. We have the name of Jesus that we can use. We have the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. We have the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We have the whole armor of God. We do not fight our fights with carnal weapons, but with the might and the power of God. We just need to remain focused and walking in our armor and walking in our might and walking in our strength. Amen. Let's all stand for just a moment. We're going to have a quick prayer.